Hi, my name is David Eckel from Endeavor Enterprises in Amsterdam, and today I am interviewing Mr. Ralph Techmeyer, aka Phantom Master, and together with me today, helping me interviewing him, is Anastasia Matveeva. She's an editor of searchengines.ru, and Anastasia, why don't you start asking Ralph? You go shoot away and I'll...
What is your personal opinion about Google's manual penalization, and what does sites really can do to return position in search in short time?
Well, I don't think that Google does manual penalizations across the board. They try to do everything algorithmically. Why? Because they think they're geeks, and B, of course, it's a lot cheaper than having manual labor. Specialized labor for that, but there's a lot of industries where they either have given up already on that, or they just have realized that their algorithms aren't that good as they would like them to be. And so we see that a lot, especially in pharma. We see it in, especially in fields where Google is liable to be sued if by some company. They think that what they're doing isn't right. You know, the research results they're presenting happens all the time. And where fraud or where fake products are involved in the pharma space, for example, that's very often the case. They're very particular about that. To find out is a site something they wouldn't want in their index, want to throw them out, or is it something they just penalize by, you know, letting them drop to 200 positions or whatever. But generally speaking, for most, I would say 99.9% of all webmasters, that's not really an issue.
And does Google try to push paid search?
Absolutely, because that's where the prime source of revenue. So at the moment, for example, it's a bit of an issue. I think I wouldn't be surprised if that would hit the courts in very major ways pretty soon, because why? They're not giving webmasters generally information what keywords searchers were using before they hit their site via Google, except when you are still on Webmaster Tools or Google Analytics, then it's a limited way, but they still do that. So the reason why I expect this to turn into litigation sometime soon is because it's basically how monopolies behave, and a lot of people are very, very unhappy about that, not just the SEO industry.
What do you think about Google Webmaster Guidance? Should SEO obey its advices or disobey? What do you think?
You see, there's very many ways of lying, and I'm afraid that's what Webmaster Guidelines of Google and other search engines, not just Google, are about. They'll tell you a part of the story, but not everything. And then you ask me, well, should we abide by them? Should we follow these guidelines? Yes, but which version? Which interpretation? Because I'm saying this because the guidelines, especially Google guidelines, they're so vague at times, so ambiguous, that you don't really know. Do they mean it this way or that way? And they're not going to tell you, not in any great detail. Sometimes Matt Cutts will address these questions in one of his weekly videos and so on. This may be completely true or not entirely true, what he tells you or whatever. But basically, you have to sort it out in some way. And so, I mean, I'll give you a nice example, which is basically an indication of the hypocrisy as well. They'll tell you, well, you know, build your website as if Google didn't exist. Pretend that we're not there. Just build it for your visitors. Give them a good user experience.
What would you advise or to wish to Russian sellers which must to promote their resources in Google or in Yandex, both search engines?
Oh, well, it depends on the language, of course, and yeah, as you mentioned, Yandex, of course, is a lot bigger in Russia and more important for SEO than is Google in Russian. If you're targeting a specific or foreign language or foreign market, then it's a different story, of course. Generally speaking, the issues you are in involved with are all the same. You need good content on your pages, you need a good page or site website structure, but you need a good link profile as well. And that's the same across the board, whether you're working in the Russian space or the Chinese or French or Spanish or German or Dutch or whatever, it doesn't really make a big difference. The rules for Yandex, of course, are entirely different than those for Google. The Yandex, for example, is very much focused on localized search, which Google has, but it's not half as extreme as with Yandex, right? So when I'm saying, well, what are my Yandex results? You'll have to ask me, well, from where? From Novosibirsk or from Moscow or from St. Petersburg or whatever. It's not general or not very sustainable on a general scale. Well, that's a different problem you Russian SEOs have, or foreign SEOs who are working with Russian space, of course. And as for Google Russia, I mean, you might as well ignore it, couldn't you?
Back to the West,
yeah.
And back to Google. My first question would be about organic search. It looks like as if the last 2 years, organic search is under stress. Is there a light in the tunnel for organic search, or this is just...
Most UK agencies, who said they were SEO agencies, made about 70, if not 90% of their revenue with paid search. So it wasn't really about SEO. I'm saying this because for me, paid search is not SEO, it is SEM. All right, search engine marketing, fine. And it is a trade in its own right, and you've got to know what you're doing there. And I highly respect people who know what they're doing, how they invest in that specific market. It's like any other advertising market. You've got to know your space. It's not the same thing as organic search at all. Well, this said, of course, Google is making it more and more difficult for everyone to actually, you know, perform well in organic search. And there's various reasons for that, and a lot of things I could say about this they would deny and say, nah, this is bad propaganda, but the awful Phantom Master, Black Hat SEO, and so on. But I've been working this space long before Google was even invented. And so I think I know a little bit about it, and I can tell you, generally speaking, the search engines are not our friends. And meaning that they're, and that doesn't just apply to Google, it applies to Yahoo, or it applies to Bing, it also applies to Yandex or Baidu or wherever. They have a different agenda, they want something else than we want. I'm on record something like 12 years ago or whatever, calling them parasites, because essentially this is a parasitical kind of existence they're leading. I'm just not saying to diss them, to bash them. I'm just saying, look, webmasters, they are not interested in you. They are interested in themselves. Hey, they're public companies. They're there to make money. I don't fault them for that.
Let me ask you about animals. Do you like animals in general?
Not all of them, but very many, yes.
Let's be specific. How about penguins, pandas, and hummingbirds?
Those are animals, I would say, that need a lot of protection from Google, because Google is abusing their cute little selves and trying to sell us essentially evil stuff. I mean, evil for us under a cute name. You know, it's like sugaring your poison, but it's not the bloody penguin's fault.
No,
hummingbird. I'm sorry, but this is Google, not us. Then you can't fault them for trying to make money of that, because they're money operations and money making companies, of course. And you can't fault them for trying to tweak their index so that the results are like what they want them to be. Okay. But yes, between every major, let's say, update with a name, cute animal or whatever, there's millions and millions of very tiny little algorithm tweaks, and they will never ever tell you about this. A lot of that is experimental as well. They may try out this for a week and then say, oh, it doesn't really work out that way. They are very much in trial and error mode as well, because their algorithm is so complex that you cannot really predict what any change, any given little change, will actually lead to. Nobody is able to predict that. And sometimes they will actually return to the previous state. But a lot of that stuff doesn't even ever get noticed, because How do I know about this? For example, I mean, we catch about 100,000, roughly 100,000 search engine spiders on our sites per hour. Not per day, not per month, not per year, but per hour. So we really have a lot of traffic. Google monitor, spider, yeah. Or let's say search engine spider traffic. I'm just talking about that.
The bird.
Yes, and of course we also monitor all the time, you know, how our client sites or the sites we are running for client campaigns, how they are performing, and so on. What this link building strategy will do for us, or why that we are trying to find out why that one doesn't work out anymore, even though it used to, you know, stuff like that. For us, this is basically, it's like you could say, not even daily, it's hourly issues we're dealing with. So on a huge scale. Most white hat SEOs don't do that. In-house SEOs never do that because they're really, you know, focused on their company and nothing else, or little else. Maybe they might monitor their competitors a bit, but that's about it. SEO agencies, well, there you would expect people to have wider experience, but then you know, there's a big problem with getting qualified SEO staff these days. There's not enough people. The demand is so high that it's very hard to get good people. The problem there is, I mean, I think it's a very American take. It's ingrained in American culture. And this, you know, back in 1999, for example, when I started my first company in SEO, it was all about ethical SEO and non-ethical SEO. Until I said ethics schmethics. This is about technology and not about morals.
If you remember, a few months ago in the United States of America, there was a big news about NSA spying after American citizens. But if I look today what we are giving Google voluntarily in terms of information about ourselves, it's ridiculous. What do you have to say about that?
You know, please don't use Gmail just because it's free. Google has officially said that they are actually reading your Gmail. Machines are doing it. Yeah. But I mean, what kind of an ado is this? You know, if it's you know, like calling my next police station and asking for a good guy for a bank robbery. Is there someone you could recommend, please? You know, I mean, it's just incredible. You're absolutely right. Yes, the amount of data we're giving Google. One thing I find, I'd say that for most all companies, if I were, you know, basically president of a company, I saw my chief executive signing up for Google Webmaster Tools and Google Analytics, giving Google all digital data about my company there is, I'd have him shot on sight. I mean, how dumb can it be? There used to be a time when companies were, you know, kind of discreet about their internal data, and usually when you sign up as an employee, you know, you have to sign up for that, and you don't run around and tell their competitors, you know, what's internally going on.
You don't need the corporate gives it, you know, on a silver platter.
But again, Google, you know, everything digital finds out all about it anyway. And if it's not, you know, just Google Webmaster Tools and Google Analytics, it'll be Google Plus, it'll be Gmail, it'll be well, whatever they're monitoring by way of social media, this, that, there, and the other. Picasa and what have you. And can we fault them for actually making use of that? I think we can, because I don't think that is within their remit. But that's a legal question more than anything else. And yes, I personally say to you, if you contact me in terms of SEO, please don't do it on Gmail. In your interest, not in mine.
Ralph, I would like to thank you very much for the very interesting interview. Anastasia, also to you. And from CES London, I would like to wish everybody a beautiful day. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.